Okay, thank you, dear brethren. It's a pleasure to greet all of you and also those who will join to us during the time. Draga braća i sestre, evo baš je velika radost stvarno vidjeti nas evo sve zajedno ovdje na našem sastanku i dobrodošli svi kao i oni koji će nam se još priključiti. Evo već se neki priključuju tijekom vremena. We will begin our meeting with the hymn. It's 251, the Rock of Ages on the English hymnals, and 171 on the Croatian hymnals, the Rock of Ages. And after that, we will have a prayer. Znači, imat ćemo pjesmu 171, Vječna stijeno, nakon koje ćemo se hime pomoliti.
You're not sharing your audio, Brother Miro. Brother Miro, you didn't hit the button, the little click the box that said share my audio when you were in the, before you hit the share screen. When you're in share screen, click the box that says share my audio before you double click on the hymn. It's only picking up from your microphone, so you have to stop your share, okay. Hit share screen again, and then before you double click on the icon or on the hymn, okay. Make sure there's a little box that says share my audio on, also down the lower left corner of share screen.
Left corner, but I don't have a... You now see the text of the hymn.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But where is the for the audio?
There's a box before you double clicked on that share text. It's only when you hit the word share screen, and then down in the lower left hand corner, there's a little box that says share my audio.
Or share computer sound.
Yes. And okay. Then now double click on the. On the hymn.
Okay. Okay, we will start again then. It's okay. And brethren, please, can you turn off your mics and cameras as well? Braćo, samo molim vas da isključite vaše, znači mikrofone i kamere, tako da se čuje samo muzika, znači i pjesma, jel? I tekst da se vidi, jel? Thank you so much. Thank you. And we will start again with the hymn 251. 171, Vječna stijena.
Thank you.
prayer. Sad ćemo se pomoliti, braćo i sestre. Let's bow our heads. Our dear Heavenly Father, Lord of the universe, we are so grateful to you for your all-compassing love that you show to us, that you brought salvation from heaven to the flesh and shed blood of your dear Son. This year's memorial is, we are still on the impression of the memorial that we had 2 days ago, and our thoughts are still on that great sacrifice, and also on our little sacrifice beside it. And we pray that we can be more successful and faithful in that sacrificing, and in that way that we can be a part of that great mediator and share and distribute the blessings to all mankind, all peoples on earth, and also to work for you, the Heavenly Father, on your glory in all eternity. We pray now for David Stein, that you anoint his lips and his mind and heart and lips, that he will speak to us words of truth, wonderful words of life. Please, Heavenly Father, open our hearts, make it receptive for these truths that we will receive, and also our mind, that we can grasp all of that and really have a benefit to be really successful and made our calling and election sure. We pray all of this in the name of your Son, our living Redeemer, Jesus. Amen. Evo, draga braća i sestre, nakon ove molitve mi ćemo započeti sa našim sastankom. Dakle, imamo našeg gostujućeg predavača, brata Davida Steina. Već smo se upoznali sa bratom. On će nam, dakle, govoriti na temu govor o šatoru od sastanka ili tabernakulu. Još jednom vas molim samo da neki od vas isključite vaše mikrofone tako da se ne čuje.
Okay. Brother David, now it's your turn.
Okay, thank you, Brother Miro. And you will need to make me a host so that I can pull up my PowerPoint when we get to that. And everyone else, if you would be so kind as to mute your microphones.
Ragip, samo ako možeš mikrofon isključiti, Ragip. Molim te, mikrofon. Okay.
Well, dear brethren, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to you.
Evo, draga braćo, dobro jutro, dobar dan i dobro večer nekima od vas.
The international character of our Zoom meetings is not simply a matter of languages, but also a matter of time.
Kao što vidite, dakle, priroda naših međunarodnih sastanaka nije samo stvar jezika, nego i stvar vremena.
But we greet you all in the name of Jesus and are here to praise our Heavenly Father together this afternoon.
No, mi vas sve ovdje pozdravljamo u ime našega gospodina Isusa Krista i svi smo ovdje ovog poslijepodneva kako bismo proslavili našeg nebeskog Oca.
This is going to be a lesson on the tabernacle in the wilderness.
Dakle, ovo će biti lekcija o šatoru od sastanka u pustoši.
I will make apologies that it will be a very basic lesson.
Moje isprike, ali to će biti samo jedna temeljna, u stvari, temeljne lekcije.
Normally, as we look at the types and shadows and symbols here in the tabernacle,
kada inače normalno gledamo u te tipove ili pralikove i sjene tabernakula ili šatora od sastanka,
we would like to look at a lot of Bible verses to back up our understanding of what the symbols mean.
Mi onda obično puno gledamo u biblijske retke koje onda povezujemo u nastojanju da otkrijemo šta ti tipovi ili te praslike znače.
But today, in order to cover as much of the tabernacle as possible,
ali danas, kako bismo, dakle, u nastojanju da obradimo što je moguće više detalja o samome šatoru od sastanka,
we are not going to do a lot of the Bible digging that we normally would do.
Nećemo, znači, ići onda toliko u dubinu kao što inače radimo.
Our objective is to give a very good and comprehensive overview of the construction of the tabernacle and its basic meanings.
Dakle, naš primarni cilj u ovome govoru je, znači, da kažemo nešto općenito, znači, o tom šatoru od sastanka, o, dakle, tome kako je on izgledao i, dakle, njegovi dijelovi, čega se je sastojao i što to konkretno znači.
Now, for your studies on your own, the tabernacle is described in Exodus chapter 25-31.
Za one koji žele znati više za vaše osobno proučavanje, možete pogledati u Bibliji izvještaj o šatoru od sastanka u knjizi Izlaska 25. do 31. poglavlje.
The building of the various pieces is described in Exodus 35-39.
Onda gradnja pojedinačnih dijelova šatora je opisana u knjizi Izlaska 35. do 39. poglavlje.
And the assembly and setting up of the tabernacle is described in Exodus chapter 40.
A dakle, samo postavljanje šatora od sastanka i, dakle, skup koji je pritom bio održan, opisan i izvještaj je o tome je opisan u knjizi Izlaska 40. poglavlje.
Basically, the tabernacle is a tent that the Israelites used in the worship of Jehovah. Another way to think of it is a portable temple.
To je u osnovi, znači, bio šator kojega su Izraelci koristili u štovanju Jehove Boga. Drugi način da razmišljamo o njemu je taj da ga možemo čak nazvati prijenosnim hramom.
So here I trust you can see a full screen of the tabernacle with the title Tabernacle Shadows of Better Sacrifices. Miro, is this coming across okay?
It's not full screen. You'll have to share it in a different way. Can I talk you through that?
Yep, I think that I have just two choices here.
So now go to Advanced Share.
All right, just one second here.
Once you click on Share Screen, it'll show you the option of Advanced Share.
Advanced, okay. Got it.
Okay, now choose the one that says Share a Portion of My Screen, and then put the little green box around what you want us to see. You can size it.
Let me back up here just a moment because I did do this before, Brother Bill, and I think I just may have.
It's worked.
You can, if you don't want to see your speaker notes, then you can just hit play full screen and it'll, then you're okay. But that's getting us a portion of the screen right there.
Okay, let me, how is that?
That's okay. Better.
That is better, okay.
That's good.
Let's make sure I can change.
Dakle, ovdje na slici možete vidjeti onda kako je taj šator otprilike izgledao.
Okay, I am good. Well, dear brethren, you see here a picture, illustration of the tabernacle completely set up within the middle of the camp of the Israelites.
Dakle, ovdje vidite ilustraciju tog šatora kako je on, znači, otprilike izgledao kada je bio podignut u, dakle, pustoši usred izraelskog tabora.
Here is another illustration of it.
Ovdje imamo jednu malo drugačiju ilustraciju tog šatora od sastanka.
Now the measurements given in this particular picture is in feet.
Mjere koje su, znači, date, mjere samog šatora su, znači, u stopalima.
And I guess in Europe you use the metric system, so a foot would be about one third of a meter.
To bi znači bila jedna trećina metra stopalo.
Now the measurements of the tabernacle and the tabernacle pieces were all given in the Bible in cubits.
Međutim u Bibliji su znači te mjere bile date u laktima.
And since cubits what is chosen, that means that the numbers are significant only in the measurement of cubits.
I s obzirom da su mjere u Bibliji date u laktima, to onda znači da brojevi tih lakata imaju svoje određeno značenje u Bibliji.
Now the tabernacle itself measured about 30 cubits in length from the door to the back of the tabernacle.
Dakle, sam šator od ulaza, dakle, pa do njegove pozadine, znači, je bio 13,8 metara u metrima.
And it consisted of two compartments, the holy and the most holy.
Sastojao se od dva odjeljka. Prvi je svetinja, drugi svetinja nad svetinjama.
Here is a floor plan of the tabernacle.
Evo ovdje vidimo topocrt samog šatora, znači pogled odozgo.
And you can see all of the furnishments of the tabernacle, both in the courtyard and inside the tabernacle, are listed here.
I možete vidjeti znači dijelove što je sve znači bilo u tom šatoru, kao i u dvorištu samoga šatora. Znači pogled odozgo, topocrt.
I should also mention that there was a courtyard around the tabernacle, as you can see here.
Također, vidite i sami, na slici znači bio je taj šator okružen sa dvorištom i to dvorište je bilo ograđeno, kao što vidite na ilustraciji.
The courtyard measured 50 cubits wide by 100 cubits in length.
Znači, u laktima je izraženo, znači no, u metrima bi to bilo dakle dužina 46 metara, a širina 23 metra.
We looked at this floor plan, but here is another cutaway view of the tabernacle.
Ovdje možete vidjeti jedan bokocrt tog šatora od sastanka. Znači sa boka, jel, pogled, rez.
Oops, I don't want to do that. Pardon me, I'm admitting people here, at least trying to at the same time, and not being very successful at that. When you see illustrations and layouts of the tabernacle,
kada vidite dakle ove ilustracije znači na ovome nacrtu šatora od sastanka,
you have to be careful because they are not always accurate.
Morate biti jako oprezni jer na svim ilustracijama koje možete naći recimo negdje na internetu, jel, nisu sve točne.
For example, in this layout of the tabernacle,
na primjer u ovom dakle nacrtu šatora od sastanka,
the veil and the door of the tabernacle are on the wrong side of the pillars.
Dakle, druga zavjesa i ulaz u sam šator i stupovi su pogrešno prikazani.
These four pillars here are actually a part of the most holy, and the veil should be over on this side.
U stvari, ova četiri stupa koja vidite ovdje bi trebala biti, znači zavjesa bi trebala biti ispred njih.
Likewise, the five pillars here should be inside the holy, and the door should be on the other side.
Dakle, ovdje je ista situacija. Dakle, isto, dakle, bi zavjesa trebala biti ispred tih stupova, a ne iza njih, kao što je na ovome nacrtu prikazano. Brethren, can you please turn off your mics? I will be very grateful. Thank you.
All right. You can see in this illustration they have the veil and the door to the tabernacle correctly positioned.
Ovdje na ovoj ilustraciji možete vidjeti da znači je zavjesa ispravno prikazana, znači i ti stupovi. Jel? Ovo je točna ilustracija.
Now someone might ask, how do you know where the pillars should be?
E sad neko može pitati, sad kako znate gdje bi stupovi trebali biti?
Well, we know because of the sockets that the pillars are standing on.
Pa znamo po podnožima u koje su ti stupovi bili postavljeni.
These pillars at the door were made of acacia wood overlaid with gold.
Dakle, ovi stupovi na ulazu su bili znači napravljeni od akacije, drveta akacije i obloženi sa zlatom.
And they were in copper sockets.
I bili su znači stavljeni u bakrena podnožja.
We know that no gold should have been able to be seen outside of the tabernacle.
Mi znamo da dakle nikakvo zlato se nije moglo vidjeti izvan šatora od sastanka.
Therefore the veil had to be outside of the pillars in order for them not to be seen.
Prema tome zavjesa je onda morala biti ih pokrivati ako se oni nisu mogli vidjeti.
And the fact that the pillars were in copper sockets,
i činjenica znači da su ti stupovi bili u bakrenim podnožima,
suggests the scripture that we have this treasure, gold, in earthen vessels, copper.
Sugerira činjenicu znači da mi imamo tu to blago nove prirode, jel, no, kao nova stvorenja, u stvari u zemaljskoj posudi, jel, jer bakar je simbol ljudske prirode, zemaljske prirode.
That is a description of the holy condition, the condition of being spirit begotten but not yet spirit born.
To je dakle u stvari opis dakle duhom začetog stanja. Ne još pojedinac još nije znači rođen od duha, nego samo je začet od duha, jel? To je to stanje opisano u, sa time.
In a similar fashion, the four pillars that are in front of the veil or behind the veil, I guess we should say.
Ista znači stvar je sa ovim sa ovom drugom znači zavjesom i tim stupovima tamo što vidite znači koja treba, koji trebaju biti iza zavjese, jel?
These are in silver sockets.
Interesantno je, ti stupovi su u srebrnim podnožima bili postavljeni.
So the gold pillars in silver sockets suggest that which is gold is now truly gold.
I isto su bili znači obloženi sa zlatom. I ti stupovi to nam pokazuje da ono što je predočeno znači sa zlatom je uistinu zlato.
That is to say truly of the divine nature, no longer in part.
Odnosno to je sada stvarno božanska priroda, nije samo djelomično, nego stvarno potpuno.
We are now going to look at some of the furniture in the tabernacle.
Sada ćemo se upoznati malo sa znači dijelovima, sa opremom šatora od sastanka.
We'll start out with the altar of burnt offering.
Započet ćemo sa žrtvenikom za žrtve paljenice.
Now our slide here says it's a bronze altar.
Dakle na ovoj slici možete vidjeti dakle piše da je to bio bakreni žrtvenik.
That is somewhat incorrect. It really should be copper.
U stvari na engleskom piše od bronce, no to baš nije skroz točno. Trebao bi biti bakreni oltar ili žrtvenik.
This altar measured 5 cubits on a side. It was a perfect square.
To je dakle bio savršeni kvadrat, 2,3 metra sa 2,3 metra.
And it was 3 cubits high.
I 1,38 metara visine, znači 1,3 metra visine.
It was like much of the other furniture in the tabernacle made of acacia wood overlaid with copper in this case.
I bio je kao i veliki dio u stvari dijelova šatora od sastanka napravljen od drveta akacije i bio je obložen sa bakrom kao i dakle mnogi dio, drugi dio opreme konkretno u dvorištu šatora.
Copper is a symbol of perfect human nature.
Bakar je simbol savršene ljudske prirode.
When copper is used to refer to the church, it represents our justified human nature.
Kada se bakar odnosi na klasu crkve, to se onda odnosi znači na našu na naše opravdanje, znači pripisanu savršenost od Boga.
This is exactly the reason why we mentioned a moment ago that the gold pillars at the door of the tabernacle were in copper sockets.
Ako se sjećate, to smo bili malo prije spomenuli kad smo govorili o tim stupovima na ulazu u šator, jel, da su oni bili od zlata, ali da su bili znači stavljeni u bakrena podnožja, jel, znači u blago u zemljanim posudama.
This copper altar, this altar of burnt offering, is where all of the sacrifices of the tabernacle were consumed.
Znači, ovaj žrtvenik je znači bio taj na kojemu su se sve zapravo žrtve u u dvorištu spaljivale, jel?
As such, it was a central part of the tabernacle's operation.
Kao takav, on je bio središnji dio funkcije djelovanja šatora od sastanka.
The altar of burnt offering represents the sacrifice of Jesus.
Žrtvenik za žrtve paljenice predočava Isusovu otkupnu žrtvu.
His human nature is suggested by the copper.
Njegova ljudska priroda je predočena sa tim bakrom.
And this altar of Jesus, if we can call it that, is the basis for all other sacrifices.
I taj Isusov žrtvenik, ako ga tako možemo nazvati, je temelj za sve druge žrtve.
So it is appropriate that it commands a central part of the courtyard.
Istoga je prikladno da onda je on u stvari ono prvo na što nailazimo kada ulazimo u samo dvorište toga šatora.
Behind the altar of burnt offering, but before the door of the tabernacle, is the copper laver.
Odmah nakon žrtvenika za žrtve paljenice nalazio se bakreni umivaonik, ali znači prije ulaza u sam šator od sastanka.
The size and shape of this copper laver are not specified in scripture.
Znači, veličina, dimenzije tog bakrenog umivaonika je neodređena. Znači, nemamo u Svetom pismu informacije o dimenzijama.
This was where the priests would wash before they participate in the tabernacle sacrifices.
Dakle, tu bi se svećenici prali prije nego što bi prinašali žrtve, dakle, u šatoru od sastanka.
The copper from which this laver was made was a very special copper.
Bakar od kojega je taj umivaonik bio napravljen je bio veoma poseban bakar.
Today we have mirrors to be able to see ourselves.
Danas imamo ogledala u kojima se možemo vidjeti.
Back in the time of Moses, they did not have glass mirrors.
No, u Mojsijevim danima nisu imali takva ogledala.
Instead, they used polished metal.
Umjesto toga, oni su koristili ispolirani metal.
Copper was a relatively inexpensive metal.
Bakar je bio relativno jeftin metal.
They would take the very most highly refined copper and they would make looking glasses or mirrors out of it.
Dakle, koristili bi taj veoma jako dobro ispolirani zapravo bakar koji je bio toliko dobro ispoliran da su stvarno mogli vidjeti odraz sebe u njemu. To je za njih bilo kao ogledalo.
It was this type of copper from which the laver was made.
I zanimljivo, upravo od takve vrste bakra je bio napravljen ovaj umivaonik.
The fact that God's word specifies this type of copper to be used is very interesting.
Činjenica da Biblija naglašava da je taj umivaonik znači bio napravljen od upravo takve vrste bakra je veoma znakovita.
When a priest would go over to the laver to wash in its water, he would see a reflection of himself.
I kada bi svećenik znači išao, kao što vidimo na slici, jel, prati recimo svoje ruke u vodi u tog umivaonika, on bi vidio svoj odraz unutra, jel, u toj vodi.
Now it's very interesting when we consider the meaning of this for us in the gospel age.
Veoma je zanimljivo kada razmatramo značenje toga za nas u evanđelskom dobu.
The scriptures talk about washing in the waters of the word.
Sveto pismo govori o pranju u kupelji Božje riječi.
So the water in the laver represents the water of God's word from which we can spiritually wash.
Znači, to se odnosi na Božju riječ koja nas može, ta voda, jel, u tom umivaoniku, predstavlja znači Božju riječ koja nas može očistiti.
But remember that the laver is made out of copper.
Ali imajte na umu da je umivaonik bio napravljen od bakra.
That means we have to see perfect human nature in this picture as well.
To znači da mi u ovoj slici moramo također vidjeti savršenu ljudsku prirodu.
And here is how it may be seen.
I evo kako se to, kako bi to moglo biti, izgledat zapravo.
When you and I look into God's word, we see a reflection of ourselves.
Kada ti i ja gledamo u Bibliju, znači u Božju riječ, mi vidimo odraz sebe.
God's word reveals to us every sin and every imperfection that we have that needs washing.
Božja riječ otkriva znači svaki naš grijeh, svaki naš nedostatak kojeg trebamo očistiti, oprati.
But we also see Jesus in God's word.
Ali mi također vidimo Isusa u Božjoj riječi.
We see Jesus human perfection, his perfection of character.
Vidimo Isusovu savršenu ljudsku prirodu, Isusov savršeni karakter.
So we see not only our imperfection, but we see the example that Jesus sets for us to which we reach.
Stoga ne vidimo samo znači našu nesavršenost, nego Isusov savršeni uzor ka kojem mi stremimo da to postignemo koliko god je moguće.
Let us now go into the tabernacle itself.
A sada ćemo ući u sam šator od sastanka.
Here is an illustration of the golden lampstand.
Ovdje je ilustracija zlatnog svjećnjaka.
This lampstand was made out of a single lump of gold.
Dakle, ovaj svjećnjak je bio napravljen od jednog komada zlata.
The gold was hammered and shaped to make this most beautiful object.
To zlato, taj komad zlata je bio znači toliko dobro iskovan, jel? Dakle, i onda se od njega, od tog kovanja, se napravi ovako jedan prekrasan svjećnjak.
You will notice right away that when we go into the holy of the tabernacle, we change from seeing copper, as we saw in the courtyard, to gold.
Vidite, znači kada ulazimo u sam taj šator, znači iz dvorišta, u dvorištu su svi predmeti od bakra. A kada ulazimo znači u prvi odjeljak samog šatora, u tu svetinju, kako se zvala, tu je sve od zlata.
Gold is representative of divine things.
Zlato simbolizira božanske stvari.
We can see in this golden candlestick two separate but important symbols.
Mi možemo vidjeti u ovom zlatnom svjećnjaku u stvari dva simbola, svaki zasebno, za sebe.
The first, since we know that this is a piece of furniture that gives light to us.
Onda prvi, značenje prvog simbola, što kao prvu stvar taj svjećnjak predočava.
It represents the church holding forth the word of God as the light of the world.
U stvari, predstavlja crkvu kao nositelja svjetla Božje riječi svijetu.
We can also see it as the word of God, as the source of all spiritual light.
No također ga možemo vidjeti i kao Božju riječ koja je izvor sveg duhovnog svjetla.
This golden lampstand was the only source of light in the holy.
Taj zlatni svjećnjak je bio jedini izvor svjetla u svetinji.
let's go to the other side of the holy now. The lampstand was on the left. Going in, we're going to go to the right.
Znači, kada bismo ušli unutra u svetinju, taj bi svjećnjak stajao sa lijeve strane, a onda sa nama desne strane je nešto drugo se nalazilo.
This is the table of showbread.
Ovo je stol na kojem su stajali kruhovi stavljeni pred Boga.
It did have a measurement.
Imamo mjere za njega.
It was 2 cubits long by 1 cubit high by 1.5 1 cubit wide by 1.5 cubits high.
Bio je 92 cm dugačak, 46 cm širok i 69 cm visok.
It held the unleavened bread that was only permitted for priests to eat.
Znači, na njega su bili postavljani beskvasni kruhovi i samo je svećenicima bilo dozvoljeno da ga jedu.
This illustration is good because this shows something that we don't talk about very much on the table of showbread.
Ova ilustracija je jako zanimljiva, jer prikazuje nešto o čemu baš često i ne govorimo kada inače proučavamo ovu temu, konkretno o stolu tom na kojeg su se stavljali ti kruhovi pred Boga.
This was a container or carafe of wine.
Dakle, ovo je bila posuda za vino.
So the table of showbread had both bread and wine.
Dakle, vidite, zanimljivo. Ovaj kruh je na sebi sadržavao kruh i vino.
This is certainly significant to us as we have just passed the memorial of Christ's death, where the emblems of bread and wine were very important.
Ovo je sasvim sigurno znakovito za nas, jer mi smo upravo proslavili Gospodinovu večeru, gdje upravo smo koristili, znači, i beskvasni kruh i vino, što je za nas veoma značajno.
The meaning of the table of showbread also has two parts.
Značenje stola na kojem su stajali kruhovi stavljeni pred Boga isto ima dva značenja.
On one hand, the table can represent the church as holding forth the bread of life.
Znači, jedno značenje je da taj stol može predstavljati crkvu koja drži znači Božju riječ, riječ života.
On the other hand, we also have another picture of God's word.
No, s druge strane imamo sliku isto može predstavljati samu Božju riječ.
It is giving us spiritual bread and spiritual wine.
Koja nam daje, znači, duhovni kruh i duhovno vino.
Not too long ago, I was asked an interesting question.
Prije ne tako dugo vremena, nekom je bio postavio veoma zanimljivo pitanje.
Why would God have two symbols of God's word in the same room?
Zašto je Bog imao, znači, dva prikaza za istu stvar u jednom prostoru?
We already suggested that the golden lampstand represented God's word.
Već smo, znači, spomenuli da je zlatni svjećnjak predstavljao Božju riječ.
And the table of showbread represented God's word.
I da je ovaj kruh na koji su se stajali ti kruhovi koji su stavljeni pred Boga, da isto predstavlja Božju riječ.
The difference may be understood in recognizing two functions of God's word.
Razliku se može zapaziti ako razaberemo u stvari dvije funkcije Božje riječi.
On one hand, God's word is a light. It permits us enough understanding of what God wants us to do to give direction in our life.
Znači, s jedne strane, Božja riječ je svjetlo, daje nam, znači, vodstvo, prosvjetljuje nas u životu.
But God's words also has a function of feeding us.
Ali Božja riječ također ima i funkciju hranjenja. Ona nas hrani.
We need to eat on God's word, in particular, eat on the teachings of Jesus.
Mi se moramo hraniti sa Božjom riječi, konkretno sa Isusovim učenjima.
In order to have strength to fight the noble fight day by day.
Kako bismo imali snagu da možemo voditi dobru borbu iz dana u dan.
So we have God's word as light giving us direction.
Sad imamo s jedne strane znači Božju riječ kao svjetlo koja nas vodi.
And we have God's word as the source of our spiritual food.
I imamo Božju riječ kao izvor naše duhovne hrane.
Dear brethren, just a footnote about these things.
Možda sam samo jedna opaska, braćo, u vezi tih stvari.
We could easily spend an hour going over the features of each one of these pieces of furniture.
Vjerujte, mogli bismo sat vremena govoriti za svaki pojedinačni dio opreme šatora od sastanka.
There is so much more beautiful truth in each of these things.
Ima još daleko mnogo toga što se može reći o svakoj od tih stvari.
But remember, our objective today is just an overview.
No, naš cilj danas je samo, znači, pregled, ono, generalno, jel?
Let's go on to the third item in the Holy of the Tabernacle.
Idemo na treći dio, to je, znači, u svetinji. Još uvijek se nalazimo u svetinji, u prvom odjeljku.
This is the altar of incense.
Ovo je žrtvenik za paljenje kada?
Like the altar of burnt offering, it is four square.
Kao što vidite, on je kao i žrtvenik vani u dvorištu, četverokutan.
It measures one cubit by one cubit by two cubits high.
Inače mu je ovako, dimenzije su znači 46 cm sa 46 cm, jel? I visina mu je 69 cm.
It too was made of acacia wood overlaid with gold.
I on također je bio izrađen od drveta akacije, obložen sa zlatom.
When the high priest would bring the censer in with the burning coals,
kad bi znači prvosvećenik ušao unutra sa kadionicom i znači sa kadom u njoj,
he would place it on this altar.
On bi onda stavio taj znači kad na taj žrtvenik.
And then with his hands crumble the incense upon the coals.
I on bi onda na užareno ugljevlje koje bi tu znači bilo, on bi znači taj kad izmrvio, znači on bi padao dolje na to ugljevlje.
This was done frequently, so we imagine that there was a beautiful aroma in the Holy of the Tabernacle.
I to se dakle radilo često i onda možemo zamisliti sigurno da je bio jedan prekrasan miris koji se osjetio unutra u tom šatoru.
Incidentally, on the Day of Atonement,
uzgredno rečeno, na dan pomirenja,
it was required that the high priest offer this incense and the smoke of the incense go up and go into the most holy before he could go in there with the blood of the sacrifices.
Naime, na dan pomirenja, prije nego što je prvosvećenik ušao u drugi odjeljak šatora, znači u svetinju nad svetinjama, on je prethodno morao, znači taj kad, opet staviti na taj kad i on je žrtvenik, jel? I onda je taj dim, on je, dakle, išao, prešao bi preko, znači kroz tu zavjesu, bi prešao u svetinju nad svetinjama prije nego što je on ušao sa krvlju žrtava tamo u taj dio šatora.
God's word elsewhere describes incense as the prayers of the saints.
Inače, Božja riječ na drugim mjestima opisuje kad kao molitve svetih.
And so it is appropriate that this altar of incense should be right up against the veil as close to the most holy as possible.
Stoga je prikladno što se taj kad i onaj žrtvenik nalazi upravo tu gdje se nalazio, što je moguće bliže svetinji nad svetinjama, pred samom zavjesom. Jel?
In this world, our prayers to Jehovah represent our closest approach to Him.
Dakle, u ovom svijetu danas, jel, molitve su, možemo reći, najbliži pristup Jehovi. To je najbliži mogući pristup Jehovi kojeg možemo imati, jel, kroz molitve.
So let's now go into the most holy.
Sada ćemo ući u svetinju nad svetinjama. To je taj drugi odjeljak šatora, jel?
The most holy had only one piece of furniture.
Tu nalazimo samo jedan, znači dio, jednu opremu, ništa više.
It was considered the holiest object in all of the tribes of Israel.
Taj predmet se smatralo najsvetim objektom među plemenima Izraelovim.
The Ark of the Covenant was 2.5 cubits in length, 1.5 cubits in width, and 1.5 cubits high.
Kovčeg saveza je bio 115 cm dug, 69 cm širok i 69 cm visok.
It, like the other pieces of furniture, was made of acacia wood overlaid with gold.
Kao i ostali predmeti, izrađen je bio od drveta akacije, obložen sa zlatom.
Even more importantly, it had a lid made out of pure gold.
Ono što je još važnije, imao je poklopac koji je bio napravljen od čistog zlata.
This lid was called the mercy seat, and as part of the mercy seat, it had the figures of two cherubim with their wings outstretched over top of it.
Znači, taj poklopac se zvao prijestolje milosti, kao što vidite i na ilustraciji, na njemu su bila isklesana dva kerubina od zlata.
As the holy represents an in-part condition, being spirit begotten, but not yet spirit born.
Dakle, kao što svetinja predočava duhom začeto stanje, znači pojedinac još uvijek nije rođen od duha.
The most holy represents being in the perfected condition, the divine nature.
Svetinja predstavlja, znači, kada je pojedinac u savršenom duhovnom, znači rođen je od duha, znači on je usavršen kao božansko biće, jel? Rođen je sa one strane zavjese. Jel?
Of course, achieving the divine nature means being ushered into the presence of Jehovah.
Onda postizanje božanske prirode znači biti uveden u prisutnost samog Jehove.
And so it is no surprise to us that we find something about Jehovah in the symbolism here.
Stoga nas ne iznenađuje što nalazimo mnogo toga o Jehovi simbolično prikazano ovdje.
With the two cherubim and the mercy seat at the bottom and the supernatural Shekinah light in the middle.
Dakle, sa ova dva kerubina od zlata, onda taj poklopac sam čisti od zlata, i također Shekina svjetlo, nad naravno svjetlo koje se pojavljivalo između ta dva kerubina.
We have our attention drawn to the four primary characteristics of Jehovah.
Naime, nama se tu skreće pažnju na Jehovine četiri glavne karakteristike ili četiri glavna svojstva.
You may remember that it was upon the mercy seat that the blood of the atonement day sacrifices was sprinkled.
Dakle, ako se sjećate, krv žrtava na dan pomirenja je bila škropljena upravo po tom poklopcu, znači po prijestolju milosti.
You may remember that that blood was sprinkled on and before the mercy seat.
Sigurno se sjećate, znači, da je ta krv bila poškopljena po njemu, ali i ispred njega.
The configuration of a cross comes to mind when we think of on and before the mercy seat.
Odmah nam dolazi slika križa, dakle, na um, jer, dakle, bilo je škopljeno po njemu i ispred njega. Znači, to je konfiguracija križa, odmah se prikazuje na taj način.
So since the mercy seat received the blood of the sacrifices, we may suggest that it represents God's justice.
Dakle, s obzirom da onda krv je poškopljena po tom prijestolju milosti, onda sugeriramo da to predstavlja Jehovinu pravdu.
Between the wings of the cherubim,
između krila ova dva kerubina,
is where the Shekinah light emanated from.
Dakle, otud je to Shekina svjetlo se pojavljivalo.
In addition to representing the presence of God, we would suggest that it also calls our mind to God's wisdom.
Osim što je to simboliziralo Božju prisutnost, mi sugeriramo da također to Shekina svjetlo u stvari je predstavljalo njegovu mudrost.
So that leaves the two cherubim.
I još nam ostaje onda dva kerubina.
When we recite the four characteristics of God, we say love, power, wisdom, and justice.
Kada, znači, nabrajamo Jehovine četiri osobine, znamo koje su to, je ljubav, pravda, mudrost, moć.
And so it is suggested that the two cherubims represent love and power.
Onda je sugerirano da ova dva kerubina predstavljaju ljubav i moć.
So the mercy seat, justice, the Shekinah, wisdom, and love and power for each of the two cherubim.
Dakle, onda vidite prijestolje milosti, ili taj poklopac je, znači, Jehovina pravda, Šekina svjetlo, njegova mudrost, i ova dva, znači, kerubina, svaki ljubav i moć.
By the way, I wish to thank Brother Edmund Jesuit, who we trust has passed to his reward.
Moram izraziti stvarno dužnu zahvalnost bratu Edmundu Jesuitu, koji inače završio svoj zemaljski put i vjerujemo da je primio nagradu.
This is part of the illustrations that he made regarding the tabernacle. All of these illustrations are his.
Dakle, ovo su njegove ilustracije koje on napravio, dakle, ovi crteži.
I will make a point of sending the PDF to Brother Miro, so if anyone wants a copy, he can distribute it.
Dakle, svi evo koji budu željeli, mogu preko mene dobiti PDF od brata Davida u vezi, znači, ovog šapa.
We have mentioned that the holy represents the spirit begotten condition.
Mi smo spomenuli, znači, da svetinja, taj prvi, znači, odjeljak šatora, predstavlja duhom začeto stanje kršćanina.
One can only get in to the holy by coming through the door of the tabernacle.
Pojedinac može ući, znači, u to stanje samo kroz vrata šatora.
The door represents Jesus.
Vrata predstavljaju Isusa.
He said, I am the way.
On je rekao, ja sam put.
So through Jesus we come in to the holy as priests.
Dakle, samo kroz Isusa mi ulazimo u svetinju kao svećenici.
We get to enjoy the light of God's word as no one but priests can.
I onda kao takvi možemo uživati svjetlo Božje riječi. To ne može niko drugi osim svećenika.
We feed on God's word as no one else but priests can.
Hranimo se sa Božjom riječi kako to niko drugi ne može osim svećenika.
And we have the privilege of prayer to Jehovah as no one else but priests can.
I imamo prednost moljenja Jehovi koju nitko drugi nema osim svećenika.
So I'm going to stop the slides here for a little bit.
E, malo ćemo sada slajdove zaustaviti na kratko.
We will come back to a few of them before we finish.
Vratit ćemo se nekima od njih prije nego što završimo.
We've already mentioned the meaning of many things, but we'd like to go back and review them once again.
Već smo spomenuli, znači, značenje mnogih od tih dijelova šatora, no sad ćemo opet se vratiti na neke od njih.
Whenever you see gold, you see things concerning the divine nature and the divine God himself.
Kad vidite zlato, znači, to se uvijek odnosi na božanske stvari, stvari samoga Boga.
Gold may only be seen in the holy and the most holy.
I zlato se, znači, moglo vidjeti samo u svetinji i u svetinji nad svetinjama.
Silver is symbolic of truth, particularly truths about Jesus as the purchase price for mankind.
Srebro je simbol istine, konkretno osobito istine, znači, o Isusovom životu kao kupovnoj cijeni za čovječanstvo.
And lastly, copper is a symbol of perfect human nature or justified human nature.
A bakar, rekli smo, simbol savršene ljudske prirode, odnosno to je bio simbol opravdanja, znači, ili pripisane, uračunate savršenosti.
Let's consider for a moment the colors used in the tabernacle.
Razmotrimo sada malo na trenutak boje korištene u šatoru od sastanka.
We see white used as white linen throughout the tabernacle.
Vidimo bijelu boju, to je bila znači ta zavjesa koja je okruživala samo, znači, dvorište šatora je bila napravljena od bijelog lana.
Remember that the linen curtain that surrounded the tabernacle was all white.
Znači, to je interesantno, znači cijela ta ograda, znači oko ta zavjesa, oko toga šatora, jel, tog dvorišta je bila, znači, od bijele boje, bijeli lan.
The gate to the courtyard was also white.
Vrata u dvorište je, su isto bila bijela.
But it was embroidered with scarlet, blue and purple, most beautifully.
Ali je bila zanimljivo izvezena sa crvenom, plavom, ljubičastom bojom. Jako lijepo je to izgledalo, taj vez.
White symbolizes righteousness.
Bijelo simbolizira pravednost.
We know this for sure because in Revelation chapter 19 verse 8.
Mi to znamo za sigurno jer u Otkrivenju 19:8
we read, and it was given unto her that she should array herself in fine linen, pure and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints.
Gdje stoji, a njoj je bilo dano da se zaogrne u fini lan, čisti bijel, jer lan fini je pravednost svetih.
We find red or scarlet also used throughout the tabernacle.
Onda isto nalazimo crvenu boju, ona se isto koristi, znači, u šatoru od sastanka.
Now red is the color of blood.
To je boja krvi.
Therefore it is an appropriate color to represent sacrifice unto death, particularly the blood and sacrificing of Christ.
Simbolizira, dakle, onda žrtvu u smrt, konkretno Kristovu žrtvu, njegovu smrt.
The red dye that was used was taken from the blood of a worm.
Ta crvena boja je bila inače uzeta od jednog crva.
This is called the tola worm.
Taj crv se zvao tola.
Again, there are many lessons that can be taken from this fact that all reflect back on the sacrifice of Jesus.
Mogli bismo puno reći stvarno detalja oko toga, ali sve u biti na neki način ukazuje na Isusovu žrtvu.
Blue is a color that represents faithfulness.
Plava boja, ona predstavlja vjernost.
So whenever you see blue, we're talking about faith.
Znači, kad god vidite plavu boju, tu govorimo o vjeri.
Why blue?
Zašto plava boja?
Our dear brother Fry used to have a beautiful illustration.
Naš dragi brat Fry je imao jednu prekrasnu ilustraciju u vezi s time.
When the rays of light from the sun strike the atmosphere,
kada zrake sunca dođu u atmosferu zemlje,
the most favorable reaction of the atmosphere is to produce the color blue.
Najpovoljnija reakcija atmosfere je da proizvede plavu boju.
So too, when the rays of truth come into the mind and heart of an individual,
zato kada zrake istine dođu u pojedinca,
the most natural and beautiful reaction is the development of faith.
Najprirodnija reakcija je da se razvije vjera.
Our third color is purple.
Naša treća boja je purpurna ili ljubičasta.
In ancient times, purple was the color of royalty.
Inače, u drevnim vremenima to je bila boja plemstva.
It is always associated with kingship.
Znači, uvijek je povezana sa kraljevima, jel? Sa kraljevskim visočanstvom, ta boja, znači, ljubičasta.
And so purple symbolizes our hope to be kings with Jesus.
Isto ga ta boja, znači, ljubičasta simbolizira našu nadu da ćemo biti kraljevi i svećenici sa Isusom.
Incidentally, there was no black in the tabernacle.
Što je vrlo zanimljivo, nije bilo crne boje u šatoru od sastanka.
Now let's take these three colors, blue, scarlet, blue, and purple.
E sad uzmemo te tri boje, znači crvena, plava i purpurna.
In fact, let me change the order to say blue, scarlet, and purple.
Odnosno, plava, crvena i purpurna.
Blue represents faithfulness.
Plava predstavlja vjernost.
Red represents sacrifice unto death.
Crvena predstavlja žrtvu u smrt.
And purple represents the crown of royalty.
I znači plava predstavlja pardon, ljubičasta, odnosno purpurna predstavlja znači krunu kraljevstva.
Now with this in mind, let's read Revelation chapter 2 verse 10.
Imajući to na umu, čitajmo Otkrivenje 2:10.
Be thou faithful, blue, unto death, red, and I will give thee the crown, purple, of life.
Da, tamo stoji, budi vjeran, to je plava, jel? Do smrti, to je crvena, i daću ti vijenac života, to je, znači, purpurna ili ljubičasta.
Isn't that beautiful?
Nije li to prekrasno?
It is as if Revelation 2:10 is plastered throughout all of the tabernacle.
To je kao da Otkrivenje 2:10 dakle se reflektira po cijelom šatoru od sastanka.
Now a few more symbolisms, some of which we've already mentioned.
Da spomenemo još nekoliko simbola koje smo već i prije spomenuli.
Most holy represents the condition of being spirit born, the reward of faithful service, the divine nature, immortality, incorruptibility.
Dakle, svetinja nad svetinjama predstavlja stanje onih koji su rođeni od duha, što je nagrada za vjernu službu, božanska priroda, besmrtnost, neraspadljivost.
The holy represents the condition of being spirit begotten.
Stanje predstavlja, znači, stanje, pardon, svetinja predstavlja stanje duhom začetih kršćana.
The door to the holy represents the death of the human will.
Znači, sama ova zavjesa ili ulaz u sam šator, ili ta, da ih zovemo vrata, znači, to predstavlja, to jest kad se uđe u sam šator, zavjesa koja je dijelila znači, svetinju od svetinje nad svetinjama, predstavlja smrt ljudskog tijela.
The veil between the holy and the most holy represents the death of the human flesh.
Znači, vrata šatora od sastanka, znači, prva zavjesa, smrt ljudske volje, to je to posvećenje, a znači, druga zavjesa, opet ponavljam, između svetinje i svetinje nad svetinjama, je predstavljala smrt ljudskog tijela.
The courtyard outside of the tabernacle represents the condition of faith of believers in Christ.
Dakle, dvorište izvan samog šatora od sastanka predstavlja stanje vjere, znači one koji vjeruju u Krista.
Put another way, it represents justification by faith.
Odnosno, drugim riječima, predstavlja opravdanje vjerom.
Now, we might be technical and say that it represents tentative justification.
Odnosno, da budemo malo konkretniji, predstavlja okvirno opravdanje. Znači, ne skroz potpuno, okvirno opravdanje.
But the point here is that those within that condition do have faith, they do believe.
Ali poenta u tome, znači, da oni koji jesu u tom stanju, znači, oni imaju vjeru. Znači, oni vjeruju u Krista, jel?
The courtyard fence, which was also made of linen, represents the division between believers and unbelievers.
Onda ona lanena zavjesa, što smo govorili, što je okruživala šator, lanena zavjesa, jel, ili zid dvorišta, to predstavlja granicu vjere. Vjernici unutra, nevjernici vani.
When we believe, we are able to see things that others are not.
Kada vjerujemo, mi smo u stanju vidjeti stvari koje drugi vani ne mogu vidjeti.
The courtyard linen fence was 5 cubits high.
Lanena zavjesa je bila 2,3 metra visoka.
So that's 7.5 feet.
Dakle, to je visoko, jel? 2,3 metra.
So unless you are a professional basketball player, you can't see over it.
Onda ako nisi bio profesionalni košarkaš, koji su obično jako visoki, nisi mogao vidjeti šta je unutra.
Those outside, represented by unbelievers, cannot see anything of faith.
Znači, oni izvana, jel, u taboru izraelskom, jel, oni bi predstavljali ljude izvana, jel, koji nemaju vjeru, oni ne mogu vidjeti čase i vidjeti stvari koje vide oni koji su unutra, koji pokazuju vjeru, koji su u tom stanju, jel.
Now you may remember in an earlier slide we saw the tabernacle surrounded by the tents of Israel.
Ako se sjećate, dakle, kad smo imali ovu PowerPoint prezentaciju, vidjeli ste, znači, da je taj šator sa tim dvorištem, znači, on je bio usred izraelskog tabora. Izraelski tabor je bio posvuda unaokolo, oko tog.
The camp of Israel represents the world in need of deliverance from death.
Znači, taj izraelski tabor predstavlja svijet kojemu je potrebno izbavljenje od grijeha i smrti.
Now we're going to take a little imaginative trip.
Sada ćemo krenuti na jedno ovako zamišljeno putovanje.
We are going to imagine ourselves very slowly progressing from sin and unbelief all the way up to the reward that Jehovah has for the called.
Znači, krećemo od stanja nevjernika do konačne nagrade kod samog Jehove, znači onih koji će biti kod samog Jehove Boga.
Now pretend for a moment that you are an Israelite living back in those times.
Ajde, sad zamisli da si Izraelac koji je živio u to vrijeme onda.
You're outside the tabernacle, what can you see?
I ti si izvan šatora od sastanka i što onda ti možeš vidjeti vani?
You can't see inside too well. We already mentioned how high the linen curtain was.
Rekli smo, ne možeš vidjeti ništa unutra, jer spomenuli smo koliko je bila zavjesa visoka.
And in sunlight it would have been bright and white.
I za danjeg svjetla ti bi vidio, to je bilo bijelo. Ti bi to bi vidio, jel? Bilo je svjetlo bijelo, prekrasna bijela boja.
So as you walk around the courtyard and you come to the gate.
I onda recimo sad zamisliš da hodaš okolo tog, jel, tih zavjesa i dolaziš do vratiju.
You see something different and something beautiful.
I vidiš nešto drugačije, nešto predivno.
You see blue and scarlet and purple embroidered on this gate in a most beautiful and eye-catching way.
I vidiš izvezenu plavu, grimiznu i ljubičastu boju, nešto što mora da je bilo prelijepo, prelijepo izgledalo.
You would also begin to smell something very good.
I također bi osjetio neki jako lijepi miris.
Have you ever smelled a good steak on the frying pan?
Jesi možda ikada osjetio neki miris nekog lijepog jela?
That's the type of smells that would begin to be smelled from the altar of burnt offering.
Naime, to bi bio miris koji je dolazio sa ovoga bakrenog žrtvenika za žrtve paljenice.
You know that they didn't burn the hide and hair there.
Znate da nije se tamo bilo što spaljivalo na tom žrtveniku.
They burned the internal organs and it would have given a beautiful culinary smell.
Dakle, na njemu su se spaljivale unutarnji organi životinja, jel? Ne koža i dakle druge ti, nego unutarnji organi. I to je onda jako lijepi miris ovoga proizvodilo.
Now the picture here is again a very beautiful one.
Slika, tu je jedna samo prekrasna slika.
Those that are being called by Jehovah.
Oni koji su bili pozvani od Jehove.
Would see the white righteousness of Jesus, the white curtain, and be very attracted by it.
Dakle, oni bi vidjeli tu, znači, bijelu boju, jel, to je u stvari Kristova pravednost. I to je ono što bi ih privuklo.
The beautiful embroidery on the gate would be the first introduction to faith, to sacrifice and to reward.
Prekrasan vez na vratima, kojeg smo spomenuli, bi bilo prvo uvođenje u vjeru, žrtvu i nagradu.
In America we have something called passing the smell test.
U Americi imamo nešto što znači proći test mirisa.
In other words, it is a measure of if something is true or not.
odnosno drugim riječima, to je kao mjera, je li odmjeravanje, je li nešto istina ili nije.
The beautiful smells coming from inside the court would also be very attractive.
Dakle, onda prekrasni mirisi koji bi dolazili iz dvorišta bi također bili vrlo privlačni.
And so we as prospective Christians, we go through the gate and into the courtyard.
I onda mi kao, znači, budući kršćani prolazimo kroz ta vrata i ulazimo u dvorište.
We are already exhibiting some measure of faith.
Mi već pokazujemo određenu mjeru vjere.
It's a simple and maybe even feeble faith to be sure, but faith nevertheless.
To je jednostavna i slabašna vjera do duše, ali ipak je to vjera.
What does this new believer first see?
I što taj novi vjernik prvo vidi kada uđe u dvorište?
He sees the altar of burnt offering and the priests offering the sacrifices on the fiery altar.
Znači, vidio bi taj žrtvenik za žrtve paljenice i svećenike koji prinose žrtvu na tom na vatri toga žrtvenika.
We remember we said that this altar represents Jesus.
Sjećamo se da taj žrtvenik predstavlja Isusa.
And so a new believer now starts to understand in a very little way the sacrifice of Jesus.
Iz toga novi vjernik, znači, počinje na jednostavan način uviđati, razumjeti, shvaćati, jel, Isusovu žrtvu.
The copper represents the perfect humanity of Jesus that was laid down in sacrifice.
Bakar predstavlja njegovu Isusovu savršenu ljudsku prirodu koju je položio u žrtvu.
And a new believer who is learning this in the pages of the Bible.
I novi vjernik koji to onda uči iz Biblije o tome, jel?
Sees not only the beauty and perfection of Jesus.
On ne vidi samo onda ljepotu i savršenstvo Isusa,
but his willingness to bear fiery experiences for us.
Nego i njegovu spremnost da podnosi vatrena iskustva za nas.
Just as whatever was placed on the altar was entirely consumed and went up to God.
Baš kao što sve što je bilo, znači, stavljeno na taj žrtvenik bi bilo u potpunosti, znači, spaljeno, jel? I onda bi se dim uzizao k Bogu.
So the new believer sees the consummation of Jesus' sacrifice in his death and hears about his resurrection.
I tako novi vjernik, znači, vidi Isusovu žrtvu, jel, kako je ona dovršena i kako Isus je kako Isus uskrsava, odlazi k Bogu, jel?
And that Israelite representing a new believer is now even closer and can smell more delightful the smells from the altar.
I taj Izraelac, jel, on osjeća se privučen tome jer mu to miriše lijepo.
Remember, on several occasions Jehovah describes it as a sweet smelling savor.
Na nekoliko mjesta u Bibliji se to naziva da je to za Jehovu bio ugodni miris, jel, miris te žrtve sa žrtvenika. Jel.
So the new believer with his faith growing seeks even more.
Onda novi vjernik, jel, sa vjerom koja se razvija, koja raste, on sad želi još više znati jer mu to miriše, jel, ovoga privlačno mu je to i želi još više učiti.
So the next thing that this new believer sees as this Israelite walking through the courtyard is the copper laver.
I onda sljedeća stvar koju će taj novi vjernik, jel, koji je ušao unutra vidjeti je bakreni umivaonik.
Remember, this means that he is looking into God's word and learning.
Sjećate se, dakle, da to znači da on gleda u Božju riječ i da uči iz nje.
The new believer sees himself in the reflection of the laver.
Dakle, novi vjernik, on vidi odraz sebe u tom bakrenom umivaoniku.
He realizes how far short he has fallen, that he is a sinner.
On, dakle, uviđa u kakvom palom stanju se on nalazi, da je on grešnik.
But he also sees the perfections of Jesus that were laid down for our behalf.
Ali također vidi dakle, Isusa, njegovu savršenu prirodu.
Again, his attention is continually focused on Jesus.
Vidite, opet, njegova pažnja je stalno usmjerena prema Isusu.
He begins to hear the call, the high call.
On počinje, on čuje taj uzvišeni zov.
The call says, follow me, give up your life as I did, and I will have a reward for you.
Zov kaže, slijedi me, odustani od svog života kao što sam i ja od svoga i dobit ćeš nagradu.
So this new Christian, freshly washed in God's word, now comes up to the door of the tabernacle.
Isto ga taj novi kršćanin, dakle očišćen sa riječju Božijom, prilazi ka vratima ili toj prvoj zavjesi šatora.
This door is much larger, much taller than the gate he came through.
Naravno, taj ulaz je mnogo viši nego vrata kroz koja je došao, kroz koja je ušao u dvorište, jel? Već su dimenzije.
10 by 10 cubits, 15 feet, I guess that's about 5 meters.
Da, oko 5 metara je bila općenito, znači oko 5 metara, znači dimenzija, 5 puta 5.
By the way, just a little footnote.
Možda samo kratko jedna opaska.
The gate measured 20 cubits long by 5 cubits high.
Dakle, dvorište je bilo, to je jako zanimljivo, znači 211 četvornih metara.
That is equal to 100 square cubits.
Dakle, to je ovako, znači 230 centimetara sa 920, to iznosi 211,6 i 460 puta 460, to je isto iznosi, isti iznos, 211,6 četvornih metara.
The door of a tabernacle measuring 10 by 10 cubits is also 100 square cubits.
I zanimljivo da i sama vrata, znači vrata kapije i vrata dvorišta, kapije, to je kapija dvorišta i vrata šatora su znači iste mjere.
100 is Jesus' number in the tabernacle.
Inače konkretno u stopalima, znači 100 je Isusov broj u šatoru od sastanka.
And so we see Jesus is very much a part of this process, the gate and the door.
Onda vidite, znači vrata ili kapija dvorišta i vrata samog šatora vidimo u jednom i u drugom, znači po dimenzijama, jel, vidimo zapravo Isusa u mnogome.
Standing at the door of a tabernacle, the Israelite representing a new believer now has a choice to make.
I sad znači taj novi vjernik, on je došao pred znači vrata samog šatora i on sad stoji pred izborom. Treba doneti odluku.
One cannot enter the holy of the tabernacle without a full consecration.
Naime, pojedinac ne može ući u taj prvi odjeljak, u svetinju, bez potpunog posvećenja.
And the new believer recognizes the call in Romans 12:1.
I novi vjernik, on zapaža zov zapisan u Rimljanima 12:1.
I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service.
Zaklinjem vas stoga, braćo, milosrđem Božim, prinesite svoja tijela na žrtvu živu, svetu, ugodnu Bogu kao svoje razumno bogoslužje.
So the new believer now enters through consecration to the Heavenly Father in Christ, enters into the holy.
I onda kada to se, dakle, kada novi vjernik napravi to posvećenje, znači nebeskom Ocu, on ulazi u svetinju, to jest u to stanje koje je predstavljeno sa svetinjom.
The new believer has consecrated his human life to death, as represented by that door, and now goes into the blessings of the spirit-begotten condition.
Dakle, novi vjernik je žrtvovao svoju ljudsku volju. Dakle, to predstavlja ta vrata šatora, smrt ljudske volje. I znači nakon toga on dobiva blagoslove života koji je predstavljen sa znači svetinjom, duhom, začeto stanje, jel, kršćanina koji je u tom stanju, jel.
He can appreciate, as we mentioned earlier, the light from God's word in a way that the non-spirit begotten cannot.
On može cijeniti svjetlo Božje riječi kako onaj ko nije duhom začet ne može nikako ni cijeniti ni svačati to svjetlo.
Even those justified by faith or tentatively justified by faith cannot embrace the truths that come from God's word when you are in the holy.
Čak ni oni koji su u dvorištu, znači oni koji su okvirno opravdani, ne mogu shvatiti istine koje mogu oni koji su u stanju svetinje, koji su duhom začeti.
God feeds you the bread of life as shown in the showbread.
Dakle, Bog vas hrani sa kruhom života, kao što je predstavljeno sa onim stolom, jel, na kojem su bili kruhovi stavljeni pred Boga.
Our new creature now begins to develop and mature.
Naše novo stvorenje se sada počinje razvijati, počinje sazrijevati.
And of course, a necessary part of this is continual prayer to the Heavenly Father.
I naravno, neophodan dio tog razvoja je stalna molitva našem nebeskom Ocu.
The altar of incense gives us that privilege as is had by no others.
Kadion i žrtvenik nam daje tu prednost kakvu nitko drugi nema.
After a period of time during which the new creature is developed and comes to completeness,
nakon jednog određenog vremena, nakon što je to novo stvorenje, znači razvijeno, dakle njegov razvoj, da kažemo, zaokružen,
the time will come when the Heavenly Father says, it is finished, come up higher.
Dolazi vrijeme kada nebeski Otac kaže, gotovo je, sada ideš na viši nivo.
And we go through the second veil.
I mi onda prolazimo kroz drugu zavjesu.
We talk at our brethren that have gone beyond the veil, and this is exactly what we are speaking of.
Mi često koristimo taj izraz kad govorimo o našoj braći koja su, znači, umrla, da su otišli sa onu stranu zavjese. To se na to odnosi.
And of course, entering the most holy shows us entering into the divine family of Jehovah.
Dakle, ulazak u svetinju nad svetinjama, znači, predstavlja ulazak u Jehovinu obitelj sinova.
All right, let me see if I can share my screen once again. We have just a couple more slides to share.
Još nekoliko ćemo slajdova pokazati.
All right, we saw that one. Let us go on to this one. This description that we have used our imagination to describe the progress from unbelief unto the divine nature, of course, is something that all of us have gone through.
Dakle, ovdje imamo taj, dakle, put, jel, put prema gore, jel, dakle, korake koje su predstavljene sa tim nekim elementima šatora, korake koje smo većina od nas već napravili.
Jesus never started from outside of the camp because he was perfect.
Isus nikada nije započeo sa stanjem izvan ovoga dvorišta, jer on je bio uvijek savršen.
But other than that, we are following the footsteps of our master all the way through.
Ali, dakle, mi ipak slijedimo korake, jel, našeg gospodina, svejedno.
This we call the upward way.
To, dakle, nazivamo putem prema gore.
Now, when we think of upward, we think of going in a vertical direction.
Znači, kad govorimo o putu prema gore, govorimo o nečemu okomitom, jel?
When we look at the vertical heights of the various pieces of furniture, we find a beautiful lesson there.
Naime, kada gledate, znači, visinu nekih predmeta, znači tu vertikalu nekih predmeta u šatoru od sastanka, nalazimo neke stvarno zanimljive stvari.
Let's start with the altar of burnt offering.
Evo, započnimo sa žrtvenikom za žrtve paljenice.
It was 3 cubits high.
Bio je 3 lakta visok.
The copper laver has no dimensions recorded.
Za bakreni umivaonik, kao što smo to već spomenuli, nije zabilježena visina.
So since God's word is silent on that, we put a zero here.
Znači, tu smo stavili nulu jer Božja riječ tu šuti.
Likewise with the lampstand.
Slično je i sa zlatnim svjećnjakom.
The table of showbread was 1.5 cubits high.
Stol na kojem su stajali kruhovi stavljeni pred Boga bio je 1.5 lakta visok.
The altar of incense was 2 cubits high.
Kadion i žrtvenik 2 lakta visok.
The ark of the covenant was 1.5 cubits high.
Ja, kovčeg saveza 1.5 lakta visok.
When you add these together, you get 8 cubits.
Ukupno to je 8 lakata.
Think for a moment, where else in scripture have you seen the number 8?
Ajde, razmislite na trenutak, gdje u Svetom pismu nalazite broj 8?
Now you might say,
e sad ćete možda reći,
Jesus was raised on the 8th day.
Pa Isus je uskrsnuo 8. dana.
And that's correct.
I to je istina.
Remember, he was put to death on the 6th day of the week, the day before the Sabbath.
Jer sjetite se, on je bio položen, znači umro je bio položen u grob 6. dana, znači dan prije sabata.
He was in the grave all during the Sabbath.
Onda je bio cijeli sabat u grobu, drugi dan, jel?
And then on the next day, which we can call the first day of the week, but I'm going to call the 8th day.
I onda idući dan koji je bio, može ga se nazvati prvi dan u tjednu, ali mi ga ćemo ga nazvati 8. dan.
Jesus was raised.
Isus je bio uskrsnut.
So 8 represents resurrection and newness of life.
Stoga 8 predstavlja uskrsnuće, novost života.
You can think of the salvation of Noah and his family.
Možete isto razmišljati o spasenju Noe i njegove obitelji.
There were 8 souls that were delivered from the world that was into the present age, a new age for them.
Dakle, samo 8 ljudi je bilo koji su preživjeli potop, jel, i došli znači u novo uređenje, novo doba.
Circumcision of male infants took place on the 8th day.
Onda isto obrezanje muških Izraelaca isto je bilo 8. dana se obavljalo.
And you can probably think of more examples of where 8 represents this resurrection, hope or newness of life.
I još biste vjerojatno mogli se sjetiti puno primjera gdje taj broj 8 predstavlja uskrsnuće ili novost života, novi život.
Well, brethren, we're going to bring our lesson to a close at the present time.
Braćo, mi ćemo sada zaključiti našu lekciju, našu pouku danas.
But I want to tease you a little bit with other things that are still to be seen in the tabernacle.
Ali htio bih kod vas pobuditi još veće zanimanje za daljnje stvari koje možemo saznati iz, dakle, studija o šatoru od sastanka.
There are beautiful lessons on each of these bullet points.
Postoje prekrasne pouke, evo, za mnoge ovdje navedene točke koje vidite.
Bezaliel and Aholiab were the two artisans of the tabernacle.
Šatorski obrtnici, znači oni koji su pravili šator, bili su Bezalel i Oholijab.
They represent Jesus and the church.
Oni predstavljaju Isusa i crkvu.
There's a whole lesson here just on that.
Imate cijela jedna pouka samo o tome.
The silver sockets on which tabernacle rests.
Onda srebrna podnožja na kojima je sam šator bio postavljen.
There's exactly 100 of them.
Ima ih točno 100.
What do you think that means?
Šta mislite da to znači? Što to znači?
We could talk about the pillars, the boards, the coverings of the tabernacle, geometric lessons, tabernacle sacrifices and rituals, the incense recipe, the anointing oil recipe.
Dakle, mogli bismo onda govoriti dalje o stupovima šatora, okvirima šatora, pokrivačima šatora, geometrijske lekcije, tabernakulske žrtve i rituali ili obredi, onda recept za sam kad, pa recept za ulje za pomazanje.
Just about every basic doctrine of the scriptures is seen in a study of the tabernacle.
Dakle, gotovo svako temeljno učenje Svetog pisma vam se može naći u tim, dakle, stvarima kao slikama, jel? Prikazani tu u tome.
And one last observation. You've seen the chart of the ages many times.
Evo još jedno zapažanje, vi ste sigurno puno puta već vidjeli ovaj slikovni prikaz vjekova.
You see, Brother Russell took the floor plan of the tabernacle and laid it on the chart in just this way.
Vidite ovdje dakle sliku šatora ili tabernakula, brat Russell ga je tu stavio, jel, na karti.
Remember we said the courtyard represents perfect humanity or justified humanity.
Dakle, sjećamo se da dvorište predstavlja, znači, savršenu prirodu, odnosno stanje opravdanja.
If you lay this on this line, on line N, line N represents exactly the same thing.
I upravo, dakle, ova, vidite, nivo N upravo predstavlja tu stvar.
And then if we go up a little bit to line M, you have the beginning of spirit begettal.
Onda, kjete na nivo M, to povežete sa šatorom, znači imamo stanje, rekli smo, ulazak u svetinju, stanje duhom začetih kršćana.
And then the finish of our course, the death of our human bodies on line L, shows that we are ushered into the presence of God in heaven with the divine nature.
I onda smrt, znači našeg ljudskog tijela, naše ljudske prirode sa nivo L, upravo znači ulazimo u svetinju nad svetinjama, odnosno u samu Jehovinu prisutnost.
Well, dear brethren, I sincerely hope and pray that this little introduction, and that's just basically what it is, into the symbols, the basic symbols of the tabernacle, and how the colors and metals and other things are used, all of them depict truths that we have from other places. Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead, brother. Miro.
Da, nadam se da ga vraćate, da ste izvukli korist iz ovoga, dakle, iz ovih pouka, puno sam vidjeti, znači, spomenuto. Vidjeli ste i sami da, znači, svaka značajka šatora, jel, nešto predstavlja.
I truly hope that it has whet your appetite to learn even more from this beautiful subject of divine origin.
Iskreno se nadam da je to kod vas pobudilo zanimanje, interes, da još više saznate evo o tom prekrasnom obilježju u Božjem uređenju.
May the Lord bless this to you.
Nek vam ovo Bog blagoslavi. Thank you so much, Brother David, on your service, and it was very encouraging and wonderful and faith building and wet our interest for the more learning, of course. Hvala bratu Davidu, evo, na njegovoj službi. Stvarno možemo reći da je, evo, u istinu, dakle, pobudio naše zanimanje da još više saznamo, evo, tim stvarima ovoga. Now we will have 15 minutes for the questions, only 15 minutes for the questions. Dakle, imat ćemo 15 minuta za pitanja. Evo, dakle, braća koja žele, koja hoće, mogu postaviti pitanje. Our Romanian brethren also, American brethren, or from ever you are, different countries, never mind. You are free to ask Brother David, Sister Karen. Sister Karen, će postaviti prvo pitanje, Sister Karen.
Yes, Brother David, thank you so much. That was beautiful. I have two items. I thought the covering of seals' skins was black in the tabernacle. And I was taught that it would have reminded people of death to look at this big box that was black. And the other thing is, which is not an overview item, but I've always wondered, purple was made from two animals, the tola worm for the red and the cerulean mussel, which is a shellfish, for the blue. And I always wondered if there was any significance getting purple from an animal from the earth and an animal from the sea. Do you have any thoughts? But it's not important. You can well, skip it for now if you want to. Sorry.
Over. Those are wonderful questions.
Oh, Miro has to translate.
Yeah.
No, okay. Sestra Karen je pitala, znači ima jedna, naime, jedan od pokrivača na samom šatoru je bio napravljen od tuljanovih koža. I one su obično bile crne boje, a brat je spomenuo da nema crne boje u šatoru, pa je sestra malo htjela čisto da evo brat pojasni. Dakle, onda malo nešto vezano uz taj pokrivač. Kad bi promatrač bi vidio crnu kao neku kutiju, tako bi mu to izgledalo, jel? Okay, but Brother David, well, you can answer.
Yeah, what I mentioned, at least I hope I mentioned, there's no black in the tabernacle. You are absolutely right that the sealskin likely was black, and that does have some symbolism itself. Everything in the tabernacle is rather bright and rather cheery. There's nothing dark or anything like that, but the outside that it is. And on your second question, I'm not so sure about the shellfish, but you are onto something if we go back to the sealskin. The sealskin was not an animal you find in the wilderness, in the desert. It's in the sea. So its use on the tabernacle was very interesting. And I'll pause for Brother Miro to do a little translating.
Znači, sestra isto pitala vezano za dakle boju koja se dobivala, ta grimizna boja, jel? Crvena se, znači boja dobivala od tog crva tole, a dakle ova grimizna ili ljubičasta boja od dakle te nekakve morske ribe, jel? E sad, s obzirom da je to bilo u šator, se nalazio u pustari, jel? Nije bilo blizu mora, gdje onda naći tu boju, mislim, tu morsku ribu da bi se od nje napravila ta boja.
So it was a creature out of its own element. In the sense that does represent the way the world looked on Jesus. Remember, they did not see the beauties of spiritual things within him. Rather, so it's, can anything good come out of Nazareth? You know, isn't that the carpenter's son? They were always seeing something different. But Jesus very much was a fish out of water. He did not come from this earth. He came to this earth. He came from heaven and was considered despicable by his enemies. And so the sealskin does represent both the alien nature of Jesus with respect to man. He's not of the family of Adam. And of course, it represents even further how those that did not appreciate the beauties therein saw him just as some sea creature, as it were. I don't know if that answers it, but hope it helps.
Dakle, to je ovako, znači sestra je spomenula, istina je, znači tuljanove kože su stvarno izgledale kao crna ta kutija ovoga, brat je kao bio, on je bio spomenuo da nije, on u smislu kad je rekao da nema ničeg crnog, misle da nema ničeg mračnog, nema ničeg u tom smislu, jel, crnoga, ovoga, ali istina je da je ta tuljanova koža, znači, bila crna i istina je također u vezi da se je dobivala stvarno ta boja ljubičasta, znači, ili grimizna od te morske ribe. E sad, šta to hoće da prikaže? To prikaže kako zapravo svijet gleda neobično, to je kao morska riba u pustinji, jel? Nešto neobično. Znači, Isusov život ljudima iz svijeta je bio, znate, kad su oni rekli kao može li šta dobro doći iz Nazareta, jel? Znači, Isusov život je za ljude svjetovne izgledao nešto sasvim čudno, neobično, ovoga, njima to izgledalo. Znači, to je bilo prikazano sa tim ovoga simbolima, jel? I bojama, i pokrivačima, jel? I tako dalje. Evo, to je u osnovi ono što je brat odgovorio i što je sestra isto komentirala. Ja? Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Sister Joni, I think you had a question and I think it was in your chat as well.
Uh-huh. Well, I don't want to take up a lot of time here, but I was just wondering, because the table of showbread, I've never seen it with wine, a bottle of wine on the table.
Yeah, I'm as soon as I got your chat, I'm looking for the scripture and whatnot. I believe it's not translated well in King James, but there is a text that shows that the table showbread did have a quantity of wine for drink offering as part of it. I haven't been able to find it yet, but I think it's in Numbers. That's what I'm looking for. But if I remember correctly, the King James version doesn't show that, but a more accurate version does. So I apologize, I don't have that scripture handy to me for you right now. But I will find it, Sister Jody.
Thank you. I'll try to do some further research myself. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Very interesting. Very good.
Praise the Lord for it.
Dakle, sestra je pitala, kada je brat pokazao, vidjeli ste na slici, znači vidjela je dakle tu posudu sa vinom na stolu. Obično se ne prikazuje to. I sad pitala je sestra gdje se u Bibliji nalazi. U verziji kralja Jakova nije baš navedeno skroz, ali u novim, znači, prijevodima Biblije ima točno navedeno da je Sad brat se ne zna točno mjesto na kojem se nalazi, ali ima navedeno, znači gdje se baš spominje da je na stolu bila posuda, jel, za vino, jel.
Yeah. By the way, Brother Miro, it was a surprise to me too when I saw that connection. That's not something that I had been aware of. This is not too many years ago that I came across it.
Yeah, Numbers 4:17, Brother Jeff put the scripture, Numbers 4:17, ili Brojevi 4:17. Znači, Brojevi 4:17. Aha, that is a... Maybe it is here. Brojevi 4:17. Gdje kaže Brojevi 4:17. It is good news. Aha. It's different, yeah. Brojevi 4:17. I don't have that. Aha, maybe it's a...
That doesn't seem like the right one. How about 14:17? Let me see here.
Oh, no. Mislim da nije točno dan. No. Brother Jeff, it's not, but they will spread a violet cloth over the table of the presence and put on it the plates, dishes, bowls, and pitchers for the wine offerings. The bread that is always in the Lord's presence will also be on it. Numbers 4:17, Good News Translation. Da, ovisi koji prijevod, ja. Let me see.
Numbers 4:7.
4:7. Ah, 4:7. Numbers 4:7. Done. Numbers 4:7. 4:7. Four seven. Yeah. Ovdje kaže,
that's it.
Ovdje kaže preko stola za postavljene kruhove neka porostu platno od plavog grimiza i na to postave zdjele, čaše, kante i vrčeve za žrtvu naljeva i neka bude na njemu kruh koji je stalno tamo. Yeah. Very good.
Yeah, that's the one. Thank you, Brother Jeff.
Yeah. Brother Ragip. Yeah.
A sad se čuje, ja?
Yeah.
Evo i kod mene stoji, znači, Brojevi 4:7, baš ne našao sam, kaže ovako, i po stolu za prinošenje kruha neka zarasta u plavo platno i neka se na nju stave tanjure. Mm-hmm. Neka nje bude tajni kruh, jeste, stoji.
Da, spominje se, znači,
da, spominje se tačno vino, znači, to je to, ja. Yeah. A mene što mi je bilo vrlo interesantno ovom tabernaku, da... Dosta sam čuo i naučio sam naći više o tome. I šta mi je bilo interesantno, taj broj 8, kad je brat David spomenuo, nisam bio siguran ako neću da ono, ali sad znam naši da je predstavio Isusa broj 8.
Yeah.
Vrlo interesantno.
Uskrsnuće, da.
Uskrsnuće. To mi je bilo vrlo interesantno i u vezi tabernakula, kako je to bilo. Kako je to Jehova tačno, precizno, znači, rekao njima da je tačno na svaku stvar.
Yeah.
I ja mislim sad da tu normalno nije mogao svako ući u tom tabernaku. Mm-hmm. Jedino samo koji su bili svećenici. Mm-hmm. Jer, na primjer, kad bi neko ušao, što nije bilo dozvoljeno, on je stao na licu mjesta tu, vjerovatno. Mm-hmm. Nismo da uđe.
Yeah.
Osim svećenici koji su bili za to.
Tako je. Yeah.
Interesantno mi bilo, baš okay. Bilo mi interesantno to puno.
Super. But Ragib, he said that he was very encouraged. It was a very interesting talk, and especially number 8 as a symbol of the Jesus' resurrection. And he learned so much, he said, and he's very grateful for your service as well.
Yeah. Well, tell Brother Rajiv that I appreciate so much his encouragement. You know, for any of those that have the privilege of teaching the Lord's people, it is very sobering, because there's a great responsibility, but we desire only to praise the Heavenly Father. And whenever we hear that the brethren have been thrilled by what they hear, there are a few things that are more gratifying than that.
Ja, znači velika je prednost i odgovornost onoga koji poučava Boži narod, jel, naša želja uvijek da prenesemo što točnije istinu i da proslavimo, jel, našeg nebeskog oca i da se svi zajedno ohrabrimo, jel, to je uvijek naša želja. Thank you, Brother David, on that as well. Do we have maybe some questions more?
Looks like Sister Eva and Jack has her
Sister
hand
Eva.
Up.
Sister Eva, okay.
Ja sam presretna da sam došla do takih divnih saznanja i zahvaljujem se bratu Davidu. I ja prilikom predavanja, tog složenog predavanja, drago mi je i veoma, veoma mi se dopada predavanje, tako nešto sažeto i stvarno iskreno, i sama sam došla do zaključka kako se to povezuje sa božanskim planom vjekova i tako se i završilo kako to dovodi do kraja. To je predivno nešto. Sve je u skladu, u harmoničnom skladu. Dobro, sad posebno pitanje ne znam da postavim, ali jako, jako je divno. Predivno.
Eva. Thank you, Sister Eva. Sister Eva also, she is very impressed by the harmony, the harmony of the Bible teachings and the relation with the divine plan of the ages, and everything is in harmony on its place, everything fitting on its place, and that great culmination on the end of that journey of the Christian toward the reward from the start to the end. It's something perfect. She's very encouraged by that. She learned so much, she said, and she take also the notes, and she's very, very grateful to you, Brother David, on your service as well.
Thank you. Praise the Lord again.
Yeah. Evo, slava gospodinu na tome, da.
How do you say thank you in Croatian?
Hvala.
Okay.
Hvala. It's a little difficult for the English speaking people to say hvala, because you must your tongue is hvala.
Okay. Yeah, a little bit of a nasal.
A little bit different.
The Romanian mulțumesc is much easier.
Mulțumesc, yeah. Sister Emilia from Romania, or she live in France, but
mulțumesc, brother.
Pace.
We have some question in the Romanian room. Will you able to come, or you said 15 minutes because you cannot stay longer, Brother David? We would like to invite you if you are not doing something after, but if not, we can put the questions here.
Okay, I'm fine if everyone else is fine. What was the questions?
Bine, punem întrebările. The question, my first question about the tabernacle was about the light, the candlestick that should be, how you say, burning all the night and all the day. We have the scripture. Sora Tamara, acum întreb întrebarea noastră de dimineață, de Leviticul. Leviticus.
Znači, Levitski zakon.
Yes, you can go ahead and translate a little bit. 24, verses 2 and 3 and 4.
24. Poglavlje, reci 2 do 4.
What is the scriptural reference again, Brother Mero?
Leviticus.
Leviticus 24, verses 2 to 4.
Okay, thank you.
How we understand, is this only during the night, the lights, or all 24 hours, if you can tell us. Thank you.
Da li je svjetlo gorilo samo po noći ili cijeli dan, 24 sata?
Yes, it is definitely all during the 24 hours, because within the holy, it was the only source of light. So there might have been bright sunshine outside, but none inside. And so that light had to be kept burning continually. And of course, there's several lessons for us. Remember, one of the meanings of it is that it represents the church. We are to let our light shine continually. Brother Miro, I'll pause there.
Ja, dakle, svjetlo je moralo biti 24 sata gorjeti na tom svjećnjaku, ne samo po noći, jel? Van čak ako je bilo i vedro, ali to je bilo jedino svjetlo u svetinji. Znači, moralo je stalno gorjeti i ujutro i na večer, znači to je 24 sata. I to je ovoga pouka isto za nas, s obzirom da svjećnjak predstavlja crkvu, klasu crkve, jel? To je pouka za nas da mi trebamo stalno puštati naše svjetlo da svijetli kao kršćani, jel?
And you will notice there that the fuel is olive oil. It says clear oil of pressed olives. So this sort of suggests to me that they had various, types of olive oil. You can go to the store now, you can get extra virgin olive oil or just pressed olive oil. They use the very, very best there in order to minimize any production of soot.
Dakle, oni su koristili čisto iscijeđeno maslinovo ulje kao gorivo za svjetlo koje su sipali u te svjetiljke, ali to je onda gorjelo. Jel? Znači, piše čisto iscijeđeno maslinovo ulje. Znači, postalo je više vrsta tih maslinovih ulja. Ima, kao i danas, ima recimo ekstra djevičansko, ima neko iscijeđeno. Jel? Ovo je bila jedna posebna, znači, vrsta iscijeđenog maslinovog ulja. Jel?
And part of the work that the priests would do is to trim those wicks as well. If the wick got too large, it would produce more soot. And it kind of reminds us of the hymn, their lamps are trimmed and burning. Mm-hmm. You know, so this all applies to us. It is work that we must do continually as guided by the Holy Spirit.
Na isto, znači, jedan od zadataka svećenika je bio da te fitilje na svjećnjaku održava, jer ako ne bi održavao, onda bi svjetlo ne bi baš ispravno gorjelo. Jel? To je onda isto pouka za nas, da i mi moramo isto sebe održavati, jel, u ispravnom stanju, da bi to svjetlo ispravno gorjelo. Jel? Zato moramo sebe ponekad malo podrezivati, jel, održavati se u dobrom stanju kao svjetiljke, da bi mogli stvarno ispravno svjetlo odašiljati u svijet. Jel?
Okay, some more questions, Sister Amelia?
Yes, one more about the gold that was used for the candlestick. Can this mean something? Because we know that it was worked by beaten.
Yes.
This work of preparing, this can be something meaning. We to be beaten to become perfect or something like this? It was from Brother Aurel Cup question.
Dakle, sljedeće pitanje je, s obzirom da je brat spomenuo da je svjećnjak bio napravljen od jednog komada zlata i to zlato je bilo kovano. I sad jedan brat iz Rumunjske pita da li to znači da onda i mi moramo biti tučeni da bi u nekom smislu bili bolji, da bi napredovali, da bi se razvili kao kršćani.
I think that's a wonderful point. We do have to be worked into a form that is a duplicate of Jesus. And remember that the gold is very ductile. So I'm not a gold worker, but it yields very nicely. And so depending upon how much we yield, it also depends upon how much beating God has to do for this. If we yield, then the beating is gentle. You know, it's more like a kneading and whatnot. But if we don't yield, then he has to use more forceful methods in order to teach us.
Yeah. Dakle, istina je, brat je bio u pravu, jel? David se isto slaže sa time da u stvari zlato je podatno, znate, ono se da oblikovati, jel? ovoga. I tako isto, znači i mi, ako smo podatni, ako se damo oblikovati, onda ne treba puno nas udarati u smislu nekih tih životnih iskustava jel, kroz koja prolazimo, da bi se mogli razviti. Mi se moramo razviti jel, kao ovoga, naš karakter, da bi bio što sličniji Kristu. Jel. A, dakle, ako ne popuštamo, ako smo malo tvrdoglavi, ako jel, se ne damo oblikovati, onda mora ponekada Jehova dopustiti i neka malo teža životna iskustva, jel, da nas malo udari jače, jel, da bi nas onda oblikovao, jel, jer dakle, drugačije ono, ne ide ako mi ne, se mi ne damo sami oblikovati. Jel.
Da. And also not to be missed in this is that the result of that beating is beautiful work. I mean, all we can do is guess what that candlestick must have looked at, but Bezaliel under the Holy Spirit probably produced some of the most beautiful artwork that has been seen in all history. But that's a picture of the character of Christ. And, you know, we all know, brethren, that when we look at them, we think of how beautiful they are, how wonderfully do they manifest the character of Jesus, just full of love and compassion and mercy and understanding. That's the end result of the beating.
Dakle, vidite, ono što je u cijeloj toj priči ključno jeste krajnji rezultat, a to je karakter koji je sličan Kristovom. Jel? Imamo puno primjera, recimo naše braće, kako stvarno se baš vidi na njima kako su razvili taj kristoliki karakter, jel? Kako su nježni, puni ljubavi. Jel? Ovog je kako. I to je upravo ono što je smisao toga, jel? Dakle, da nas se evo, razvije, jel? Ovoga, da na koncu evo, dakle, zrcalimo poput Isusa, jel? Što je više moguće. Brat Michael Costelli.
Yes, thank you, Brother Miro, and thank you, Brother David, for that discourse, wonderful discourse. It just reminded me when I first consecrated, and the Warden W. Buell were taking me through that study. But just to support that thought about gold, we read in Job 23, chapter 23, verse 10, he says, but he knoweth the way that I take. When he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. Over.
Hey, thank you, Brother Michael. But Michael je spomenuo text iz Joba 23:10. Kaže, Job 23:10. Kaže, ali on zna put kojim ja idem, kada me iskuša, čist ću kao zlato izići. Wonderful, yeah.
That's a beautiful text. Thank you. Thank you so much. You know, and yeah, as I mentioned earlier, I would like to have pulled many, many texts like this in to sustain or at least to show where we're getting the symbolisms. But our purpose here was just to give a roadmap of what they meant. This example that Brother Michael gave is a beautiful example. There are dozens of scriptures that show that gold can be connected to us and connected to God's divine purpose in just that way. So I thank Brother Michael for bringing it to our attention.
Very good, yeah. Thank you. Da, ima puno tih tekstova što je rekao brat, jel, koje bi se moglo, jel, ali mislim, samo ovo danas smo htjeli čisto generalno ovako imati jedan govor, jel, o tome. Imat ćemo idući puta, bit će prilike, jel, kroz godinu još sigurno da o mnogim detaljima govorimo dalje. Sestra Emilija.
Okay for now, thank you.
Ah, okay.
We invite you for another of those lists you showed in the end.
Okay.
Thank you, brother. Miroslav also.
Multumest.
Multumest, Sestra Emilija.
Yeah, thank you. You might interrupt.
Yeah. Okay, brethren, we will close our meeting. Thank you all for your attention and once more to Brother David for his wonderful service to us and also to other translators on the Romanian room. And now we will close with hymn 132 on the English hymnals, My Redeemer. It's an appropriate hymn for this memorial season, My Redeemer. And after that, Brother David will offer a concluding prayer.
I sing of
Gracious Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you so much for your blessings this afternoon. We love to see, dear Father, the wonderful truths that you have embedded in the tabernacle. There are so many of them, and they reveal so beautifully your plan for us, your love of us, and of course the requirements that we have to follow the footsteps of Jesus. We pray your Holy Spirit to be upon the minds and hearts of your dear people. And upon what we've discussed this afternoon, we ask your overruling providence if anything has been said not in full accord with your standard of truth. We love you very much. We love your son, Jesus. And we thank you and will thank you eternally for the great privilege to follow his footsteps. Be with us now. We pray these things in Jesus' dear name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.